hoodwinked into the age of insanity. Was produced by Shadow Effects Productions. Stainless Steel Emotions Music. And Free Earth Radio Live.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Sure. And welcome to Hoodwinked into the Age of Insanity. I'm your host, Mark Hollander. And do we have a show for you guys tonight? We have actually some of the cast from Vika Dresev's widely anticipated movie called Flatten the Curve. And we have a couple pilots with us. We have Vika, of course, the producer and director of Flatten the Curve. And we have other cast members, people like Kevin Bobick, Josh Silver, Rob Taylor, and of course, my co-host is also part of this panel tonight. It's Rick Lotek. He's the co-host with me on a Shadow Effects show. Welcome you by Ferret Radio Live and owned by Free Earth Radio Live, the first 24/7 flat earth radio station in the world. It was started back in 2017, and we welcome all you guys in today. And first and foremost, we're going to talk a little bit about Flatten the Curve, because I have literally thousands of people, mostly on social media, that is really anticipating this project. And I think it's probably going to be the most brilliant project ever made into the community of truthers that are seeking and wanting the truth about this, not only the shape of our world, but the state that this world is actually in today. And but first and foremost, I'm going to ask Vika a question about what gave him his idea to make this documentary, and how in the heck, Vika, did you ever get the people on board, some of the best military and minds, navigational minds in the world, whether it's land, air, or sea. Vika, thank you again for coming on the panel. And Vika, tell us a little bit about your ideas for the documentary and how in the heck you got this all-star cast.
Hey, hello, Mark.
How are you?
A big hello from Spain to everyone on the panel. It's great to be here again, Mark. And on Ferret Live Radio, yeah. It's great. So, Mark, you know, the documentary is what's supposed to happen, you know? So, sometimes we have to think why we are doing some things in life and how the things synchronize together with the people you know, to the people you connect, and the feelings you have, and the confidence you have with people, and the truthers you meet, and it just grows with time, and the technology is like help us to even get this together from different places and put our creativity together and our expertise of our people here and all the cast. And so it just builds it up together, Mark. You know how it goes.
Well, I tell you what, not only am I impressed initially, I am very, very honored to be part of this project because, you know, and I have other people, other truthers, one of my brother from another mother, Rob Taylor as well, to thank for that. But and I just wanted to thank him, but thank you, Vika, personally, because I have hundreds of my friends, because believe it or not, in New Orleans, you have hundreds of flat earthers that I personally know. So it might be something in the water down here, down South Louisiana, but it's we do have hundreds of truthers, and I like to think that I was a very minor part of that, you know. But anyway, what really spurred you personally to suggest that, you know what, they're not doing these films right, they're not doing this right, they're making us look like fools, or we got trolling, you know, people that want to be celebrities, and to get people who are actually in the know on as far as the technologies that you had suggested. But how and what spurred you? Was there a certain documentary? I'm going to suggest maybe the one on Netflix. I don't know. But what got you? Because you go through a stage of anger before you make that determination and saying, you know what, we need to do this right. What kind of spurred you on to actually say, I'm going to do it?
You know, we all have been part.
Vicky, we can't hear you.
No. Yep.
Vicky, can you hear us?
Vicky, can you hear us?
Maybe that was a very intimidating question.
There he is, a little bit.
There he is. You cut out because. Right.
Holy cow.
Hey, Vika, I know I'm hard of hearing, but can you run that by us again? I think you might have muted your microphone, but anyway.
No, nothing. I think I just got some circle around, so maybe it was a disconnect. So yeah, that we all have been the victims of ignorance of evidence and expertise, which have been years around and was ignored, and this could have been done before, and it's supposed to happen. So the truth, the reality, and the team, the together we are, that's what creates the truth, the reality. And no, I would want to say many things, and you would want to say many things, and other truthers want to say many things, but no one is listening. But once we unite, that's where the power is. And this is a perfect example. A perfect example of unity.
Yep. Yes, sir.
Of sharing the truth. So
yes,
that's the main.
Unity and truth.
All right. My next question is towards Mr. Taylor. Rob Taylor, tell us a little bit about yourself, your military background, your experience, your educational background, and what the heck as far as your flying experience. Go on, Rob.
Okay, thanks. First of all, I graduated West Point Military Academy, degree engineering. Okay, call it industrial engineering, and engineering, business management, and finance, just about everything. So I studied basic engineering, electric engineering, construction engineering, physics, okay? All those physics, basic physics, electric physics, and construction physics. Following that, I went to U.S. Army Helicopter Flight School, all about it. So really the aeronautical physics and flight physics was just another engineering course for me. So that makes four physics courses or four physics disciplines that I've studied. So
plus you speak six languages, I guess, but continue.
I make that eight, Mark. Eight other than English. I'll give you an order. Fluently, I speak Korean, Spanish, French, Portuguese, and I speak two semesters of Russian. I got I got the highest grade in beginning Russian both semesters in a row. I got the highest A+ GPA. I verified it, okay, back in, 1996 or something like that. I got the highest grade because I already knew the Korean, having lived in Korean and spoke Korean for 2 years. Russian was like learning French, okay? For anybody, Russian's no more difficult than French. It's pretty simple, right, by the way. So on all the letters, almost all letters are ABCs, okay? Just check it out. It's worth it. Check it out. So I've lived overseas for 5 years in four different countries. I've literally walked in 48 countries. I speak most languages when I go there, or something that a local can pick up, or we can talk. English is the main one, as we all know. Most everybody can get by in English. So I've got some pretty good international experience. So it wasn't until the very end of my 22-year Army career, and I mean, I'm 2 months from separating from the military completely, and my flat earth brother, John Lincoln, in Houston, Texas, over the phone, he says, Rob, the earth is flat. You need to look it up. And I said, are you kidding me? That's Mickey Mouse. I'm not even going to dream of that. Are you kidding? And then 2 weeks go by, he says that, as we all know, right? Our first reaction, especially as an international pilot and And I trained with special forces too. Okay. I mean, I was pretty high when I went to my audition group physically for special forces. Okay. So I know how to navigate on the ground. I know the air maps and the ground maps. Okay. I know the navigation systems like few others. Okay. And I'm good at it. You know, and Josh, you know what time distance heading is, right? I could pick up from my point and I could land somewhere else 30 minutes, a 30 minute leg, and I could get there within 10 or 20 seconds of my plan. Okay. Number one, that shows that my flat earth map is exactly right. There is no Coriolis. There is no movement of the earth from the time I pick up to when I land. That means the earth isn't moving out from under my aircraft. Okay. Josh Silva, any pilot knows all about this time distance heading. Right. Any pilot also knows straight and level. The concept of straight and level destroys the curve of the earth. Josh knows exactly what I'm saying. Any pilot knows what we're saying. Right. And you don't have to be a pilot to know about straight and level. It's very simple. We all know what that means. Straight and level is flying straight and level at the same altitude for hours, never dipping the nose down around the earth. Okay. So here's what happened back to 2015, November, December, 2015, my buddy, John Lincoln, he said this, Rob, that's okay. You don't see, I was laughing. I was mocking the flat earth and the flat earth concept. He says, that's okay, Rob, until you research flat earth, you'll be a slave to the matrix.
Right.
And that was all I needed. Because mentally, because of Benghazi. Benghazi in 2012, I had already mentally walked away from the army. I knew it was all a lie. When he said, you'll be a slave to the matrix, I thought, okay. And so I looked into it. 3 minutes later, okay, guys? 3 minutes later, that was it. I put all of my physics engineering and flight, and I put it all into it. And guess what? 3 minutes later, I looked up, and I know the truth now. Voila.
Well, I'm going to interject you on this thought. In fact, Eddie Allen Call, who's also part of the cast, he ran one of my videos that went viral. I was coming off a Delta airline plane and asked the pilot, hey, is it a ball or is it flat? Well, it was the co-pilot, and she's, and you could see the uncertainty in her voice. Well, it's spherical, you know. However, I was coming off a flight in St. Louis, guys, and I know Josh Silva would love this. And I asked the pilot, but doggone it, I didn't have my camera on to record it. And I said, it's Captain, tell me, is it a ball or is it flat? He goes, it's definitely flat. And I walked off the plane. And I'm thinking to myself, doggone it, I should have been recording them. But anyway, my next question is to and Josh Silver, please give us your educational military background as far as being your pilots and everything. What have you come to learn? And when was your awakening? And how is it applied to what you're doing today as far as being in this earth-shattering documentary?
Absolutely, and thank you for having me on. I appreciate it. I'm not coming from the military. I'm coming from the civilian side exclusively. I do have some Air Force in my family and a lot of military friends, but I actually didn't end up going the military route, so purely civilian. I was a big fan of aviation since I was a little kid. I was always teased, nicely teased about how much I was obsessed with airplanes. I knew every airplane that flew in the sky, what engines they had, what their thrust ratios were. I was touring every air show I could possibly find and drag my grandparents or my parents to. Every documentary you can imagine. I grew up actually kind of in the country. Well, not kind of, in the country. So my grandpa would film these, would record TV shows for me 8 hours long on VHS tape. And I'd burn through one of those about once a week just on aviation, aerospace, space travel, what I knew is space travel then. So it was a huge part of my life. And after working for a little bit in my late teens, I decided that I would just go to flight school. So I thought that was the most logical thing for me to do, is go become a pilot rather than just study about airplanes. So 2007, I moved to Arizona, where you can do year-round flying, and pursued my aviation certificates while also attending university. So I attended a distance education bachelor program, Bachelor of Science in Aviation and Flight Physiology. Actually, this one was Utah Valley University. They actually had a conjunction program with the flight school that I was going to.
Okay, you were in Arizona then?
Yeah, Yes, okay. I was in Arizona. So Embry-Riddle was our competitor, flight school. That was our arch nemesis. So that's a great school too. Right? Yeah, that's a great
school. We're having a lot of background noises. Maybe Mark, you should mute your mic.
Josh, was it in Tucson, Arizona?
No, this one was in Phoenix.
Oh, cool.
Tucson was a regular spot to go to for cross-country flights, though.
Yes, sir.
Go ahead, Josh. Yeah.
We're good? Okay. Anyway, so then I went ahead and attended those flight schools, got my commercial license, ended up moving back to Northern California, where I'm actually from, Sacramento area, and began flying. At the time, it was like the tail end of the whole recession. I was able to end up flying a part-time volunteer for a nonprofit organization out of Northern California, and that's where I first started. Beginning to question, I think that's probably the start of me getting into even looking for alternative truths. So I'll never forget seeing the Department of Energy spray planes there, and that kind of set me in this mode of questioning, because I saw how secretive they were. They wouldn't talk to anybody. You never knew when they were coming in. They had block tail numbers, and I found the whole thing kind of just interesting. And so I kind of started to explore more into the truth movement, more looking for, you know, what is in, I guess you could say, the conspiracy field and everything like that.
Chemtrails?
Fast forward. Yeah, chemtrails. Yeah, definitely. I was looking into that. Oh, yes, yes. And then observing, especially when the sprays were going on big time in Sacramento, observing the glass filaments that would be all over my car in the morning. And so it just kind of starts the whole ball rolling, right? You start to explore more and more. So fast forward a couple of years, and I decided that I'm going to get my flight instructor's license to continue flying more, and that was about the only thing available at the time. So I decided to get my flight instructor's license, and I pursued all my rates. So I got the what's known as a CFI, a CFII, which is an instrument instructor, and multi-engine instructor, and I began teaching out of Northern California, and then once again decided that I needed to move to Arizona, so I did. Moved back to Arizona so I could pursue it full-time, and from there I flight instructed one of the largest flight schools in the nation, actually in the world. It's a simulator company as well. And from there, I was offered a position to get started in jets. And I started, I did the training and got my type ratings in various business jets and started flying. So around this time, this is only a few years ago, I ran into my first FE video. I believe it was a video on Jaronism. And just asking those questions, like, you know, things that I never thought of before. Like, you just take it for granted, right? You assume. I remember watching Bill Nye when I was a kid, and his little ship that goes over the model and, you know, it disappears because of the curve of the earth. And I was that kid. I was watching Bill Nye. I was watching Mr. Wizard, and I was like, yeah, that makes total sense, right? And then it takes like one flat Earth video. I swear, one flat Earth video, and suddenly.
Which one was that, John?
That was a Jaronism video. It was one of his ones that was more of the production style versus podcast. So it was a little more movie-like. I can't remember the actual title. I've looked for it since. I don't think it's on there anymore on his page. Right. So yeah, I mean, and then that kind of just started the ball rolling. I was kind of looking at him like, this is unbelievably stupid. Who would believe this, right? But I couldn't shake the picture out the cockpit window how much it changed at 40,000 feet for me. I mean, it didn't change, but my view of it changed. And ironically, at the time, I was just leaving. I was starting to fly full time, and I was leaving another position. And I worked around very smart people, engineers, a lot of engineers in the data center industry. And I remember even when I started questioning this, it's funny, people around me started bringing it up. I don't know why. Maybe it was because there was a lot of videos that burgeoned on YouTube at the time. But I would see these normally rational, very talented, nice, professional people talk about the violence they would inflict upon anybody who thought that the earth was flat was stupid enough. And I remember thinking to myself, why so defensive? Here you're talking about how anybody who questions this unquestionable belief, which supposedly has so much evidence to back it up, but anybody who questions it should be lined up and shot, euthanized, I mean, amongst other violent acts. And I'm sitting there going, well, I'm starting to look into this. I should probably keep my mouth shut at this moment. But it was shocking to me to see that. So
that's a great point that you make about keeping it to yourself, because I happen to know personally, you know, a half a dozen of my close circle of the friends that are actually closet flat earthers. because right. they don't want to be mocked and ridiculed for something that people have not researched themselves, you know, in their, whether it's their girlfriends, husbands, wives, moms, dads, best friends, but they
you
usually
can lose
are
friends over it.
Probably. Yeah. You lose family over it. I mean, more often times than not, family becomes strangers and strangers become your family, you know, over this issue. And it's really a hot powder keg issue. And but thank you for that, Josh. I'm going to move on to Kevin Bobick. And in fact, we're going to do a advertisement. I believe we got some T-shirts that we can actually for you guys supporting us in the audience, you know, Flatten the Curve. And you can get some beautiful T-shirts. And my buddy, Kevin Bobick, my newfound buddy, Kevin Bobick. Kevin is one of the main creators of this T-shirt that's going to really set the world on fire, this film called Flatten
the
Curve.
Thank you so much.
Kevin, tell us how we can order these beautiful T-shirts.
DenseyClothingCompany.com. It's really not as important to me as the awakening is. Do you know what I mean?
Yes.
I would rather just do it without making money, but I do want to make us flat earthers look good at the same time.
Boy, I tell you what, I'm going to order one after the show. It, believe me, as old as I am, I don't know. I kind of lost a little bit of things back in the 40s, so I'm not going to tell you guys how old I am, but I'm over 40. But anyway, Kevin, tell us a little bit about yourself as far as how you, your educational, military, or flying experience, and what role did you play, and tell us a little bit about your personal awakening.
Thank you so much for asking, because this is kind of something I don't really express to a lot of people. My grandfather was the test pilot for the F-15. I was born in Okinawa, Japan. I've been a military brat my entire life. My father retired as a master sergeant in the Air Force. My uncle works for NASA. I majored in Earth and Planetary Science. So I have an entire education system on the opposition side. But I took it very serious after I went to school, and my grandparents were paying for it at the time, knowing it was all BS. You know what I mean? Like, my brother kind of intrigued me. He was like, did you ever look into the other side? And I'm kind of an extremist, I'm not going to lie. So I literally went way out of my way, and I majored in Earth and Planetary Science. So after I stepped out of that and I really started taking Flat Earth serious, it became observation for me. Observable, repeatable, testable, data, hypothesis, and conclusions. That is really what it is for me. ORT is the acronym of observable, repeatable, testable. And it's kind of a funny phrase that we say over here in New Mexico. ORT what?
Right.
ORT, ORT what? You know what I mean? But it's kind of funny, but
well, yeah, and if you think about it, Kevin, you know, people like Nikola Tesla wasn't even in our science books in the history, you know, as far as educational schooling coming up, whether it's high school nor college. And we kind of accidentally found out about Tesla about 31 years ago due to the FOIA and the Freedom of Information Act and, of course, social media explosion. And I don't know if they really wanted to let Tesla out the bottle. I mean, what are your feelings on that?
Probably not at all, because the entire education system from kindergarten all the way up to Harvard was completely bought over by the Rockefellers back in 1919. Right. So the entire education system to begin with is corrupt.
It was hijacked. It was actually hijacked. And theoretical sciences, you know, people like Albert Einstein was asked one time, how does it feel like to be the smartest man in the world?
Go ask him.
His answer was, yeah, you better go ask Tesla.
How I feel about it is Nikola Tesla, he did not agree with the special theory of relativity, and he also spoke upon the firmament.
Right.
So one of the most smart people in entire human history, on our timeline rather, was a flat earther.
So you think Tesla was a flat earther?
For a fact. He did not believe in gravity. He did not believe in the special theory of relativity, and he spoke upon the firmament.
I share that feeling, and I think everybody on this panel actually shares that feeling. And but go ahead and continue on, sir.
No worries. Ask me another question.
Okay. Hey, put it back on me. Okay. Before I get back to Vika and Rob, I'm going to ask you guys one more question. And I will thank Rick for pushing the show. Rick is Rick Lowtech. Isn't part of the documentary, but he's the biggest fan. He's been a truther for years and years. And Rick, tell us what you think thus far about these gentlemen that's on this panel.
What you think of who, Mark? What I think of who?
About this all-star cast that is amongst us.
This is fantastic. I tell you what, I'm like everyone else. I'm so looking forward to seeing the documentary. I'm a little bit too late to get into it, but I've got a military background too. And I was in the Navy, and I was a flyboy in the Navy. I mean, I didn't fly. I worked on the aircraft. So I was an airman on the SS Nimitz. But this is great. I can't wait to see the documentary. How long do we have before anybody know when the final release date is?
That's a big question.
Yeah, it's supposed to be on 22nd of February, Rick, but it's not too late. It's just the beginning, Rick. There are truthers everywhere, and this documentary is really going to help inspire people to come forward and give their part, and because they will see that it does affect and helps in the change to open the eyes of the people, and that's the point, that more people will, and we're going to have more than a documentary. As Rob knows too, that we're going to have a series of Flatten the Curve. So we're just beginning.
Right.
And one thing that I wanted to add on to what you had suggested, Victor, what's really put a great impression on me, you know, personally, is that this documentary, not only the technical expertise of the cast, but we... Unlike the other previous documentaries that we've seen, and we're not going to, put anybody down who they were, but these wannabe type celebrities, these wannabe flatter celebrities wanting to make a movie. This cast that we have are people who don't want to be in a limelight. You know, actually, they'd rather be amongst their family and friends and know the truth of the world. In the truth of our reality, as opposed to wanting to go
can't
out there
see
and
what you see.
But that's
elementary school.
That's the whole idea, Mark. That's the whole idea, that we don't need to be on chick flicks to be an authentic truth documentary. So this documentary is going to help to show the people that there's a way, different way to show the truth, because it's not only about, you know, flat earth. It's all together, and at least I think it will gonna help people to look for different kind of content in flat earth documentaries, because there's really no way out. It's just the same information. It's just the same thing rolling out. It's no progress. People are making fun of the community. It's the same thing happening, and it's just so. That's the thing, is to change the way of investigating flat earth and showing the truth, and can be done in a perfect way without a million dollar per budget. And it's just the will of the people to get together, because the technology is allowing us to do that. And there we are. We are doing it together. We have the whole star cast here.
I think
it's a pleasure and
brilliant answer
to be with you all here. It's a dream come true.
Mark,
this dream is fixing to be realized.
Do you mind? Do you mind if I interrupt real quick?
Go ahead, Kevin.
I really feel like this documentary is going to make people realize that there is mass deception out there. So it's going to expand the receptors to look into other mass deceptions.
Very good answer. I was actually going to respond to Vika with this. With given the state of the affairs of the world, people are waking up anyway, maybe yes, to the wrong things, but a lot of people are, they're awakening from partly from the matrix or semi or diet woke, if you will, but people are waking up to a bunch of the lies anyway. So I think it's impeccably perfect that this documentary is coming out next month because people are waking up anyway. Flat Earth isn't so ridiculous anymore. You know, I had somebody tell me, you know what, Hollander might be right. Earth might be flat. Look at all the crap going on, you know? And anyway, thank you for Kevin. That's perfect. That's exactly, you kind of stole my thunder on that, but thank you.
No, I'm sorry.
One thing I wanted to add also is that the people, like a perfect example I would like to give is of Joshua also. We just met just when we were between the midway between the documentary, and we got connected and he became a part of it, and he wasn't publicly a flat earther, so he's in and he knows. So the trailer, he knows the impact we are making around, and now he's ready to let the world know that yes, the earth is flat, because and the people understand that, because there are comments in some places that okay, these guys are paid people to make this documentary to look like, no, it's nothing like that. We are here, we are people. He was just recently a Glover and he's a flat earther, and so I want to give an example that we all are, are trying to understand what's happening and going with our what is really resonates with us and what really makes sense, because there's a lot of different science exists, but there's a very fine line between science and pseudoscience. You know, once it starts become theoretical, it's become a pseudoscience. That's where all the lies and everything has been hided, fake maths, and we flat earthers do a lot of science. Right. It's awesome.
Right. I mean, what Kevin had alluded to earlier too, hijacked our education system in 1919. And so instead of believing in observable, testable, and repeatable science, the real scientific method, we went from that point to a theoretical mathematical equation after that mathematical equational science that actually doesn't make sense. But brilliant mathematical geniuses as they are, they don't know nothing about, they have no clue what this world's about, and they are paid to lie, and they hijack people's minds at the same time. Because when you believe in lies, when you believe in magical things that doesn't even make sense, or with your visualization, your reality of the world around you that you can actually see with your own eyes. And, we've all been hijacked. And I said something in my book, The Flat Truth, called, your eyes are useless if the mind is blind. If your mind's blind, your eyes doesn't make a hill of beans. If your mind is blind, the eyes are useless. And my question here to Rob Taylor, the last question for you guys, and Rob, once you connect the biblical cosmology with the flat earth truth, at what point did you able to connect biblical references, the scriptures, the word?
I tell you what, that's a great question. Let me make that part B. Part A is going to be this. Yes, the industrialists hijacked the U.S. education system, at least by 1919. But arguably in the late 1800s, that's when all the legislation came in to educate people to the 12th grade level, so the industrial people didn't have to themselves. It's all about legislation. So Kevin Bobick, you're right on. Exactly. Look up the homeschool. Okay. That's where the homeschool is all about. And yes, right. I've been in that since 2005. I've got essays and volumes on that.
Well, not to shorten your take on this, but let me ask you a question specifically. How many Bible verses suggest a stationary earth? kind of leave
some
the
will
show
say
because we're running out of time here. Go ahead.
I know a Bible website, BibleFlatEarth.com.
BibleFlatEarth.com.
BibleFlatEarth.com. It's got references. It lists several Bible verses from an engineering standpoint, and then it's got an entire list of other websites.
Right.
There you go. Right.
Right. Well, great. Josh, I have a question for you, sir. Mr. Silver.
Yes.
Did your Flat Earth Awakening, did it bring you closer to God from a spiritual aspect?
Oh, absolutely. From a spiritual aspect, I don't know. It's kind of a feeling that I've seen talked about before amongst people, is that there's kind of an inner peace that comes along with it. This comes to people that they could either be Bible believers or non-believers alike, it seems like. But when that veil is lifted, when that illusion seems to be lifted, or it's cracked for the first time, it does bring a tremendous amount of peace, and it does seem to bring you definitely closer to the divine. I felt that immediately. And it's funny because I could look at a sunset, I could look at the sky out the window, I could look out the front of an airplane as I was flying it at 40,000 feet, and suddenly the insignificance that's painted by the mainstream religion of science, that we are insignificant little specks in the universe that don't matter, suddenly that all loses a lot of credibility. And it definitely did for me. And it was quite amazing. And it's one of those things that you want to share with everybody, but it's kind of the pearls before swine theory, not calling people swine, calling the lack of knowledge and the lack of wanting that knowledge. To be careful of who you share it with. And that's where I've been all the way basically up until getting the chance to meet Vika through a Facebook comment, and it kind of snowballed from there. And then here I am, and I get a chance to meet with like minds and learn from you and learn from everybody that's going to be watching. And I appreciate it very much.
That's awesome, Josh.
In conclusion, Josh, actually, everything around you is so much more beautiful. The stars in the sky, knowing they're not light years away, they're closer. You're God's special creation. God created man in his own image. He didn't create man in monkey ape image, you know. And that's a beautiful question, beautiful answer, hey, actually.
By the way, Mark, I just sent the link to Eddie.
Okay, great. Eddie Allen Carr may very well be joining us, you know, towards the end of the show. Now, this question is going to be for Kevin Bobick. Kevin, as far as given the expertise, military as well as NASA space, your family is very, 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 I'm very impressed by your background in particular, especially some of your family members, which actually influenced you to get into it as well. How, when you came into your awakening, how much, how was that taken in from your other members of your family, and how did it affect your relationship, if any, and how are they now, given the fact the world's going insane now, you know? So how did that affect you personally, and what did you do about it personally?
Well, it really made my circle a lot smaller than it was, because it really pinpointed who my real friends were. Because my real friends don't let an astronomical ideology come between relation. Do you know what I mean?
Right.
So my friends, I lost a lot of friends, yes, of course. My family, though, they're always going to be there for me regardless. You know what I mean?
Amen. Whether
5 years later or 6 years later, however long it's been, you know what I mean? Like, some of them are eventually coming around. And I'm not going to judge them. I'm not going to let that affect my relation with my family to begin with. Because what I found personally is that relation is the most priceless thing ever. So whether you're Buddhist or Christian or Catholic or whatever, don't let that affect your relation with your family.
Right.
And it's harder to be the bigger person to be able to express that and to show that. Even for my dad. You know what I mean? My dad's like head honcho, jefe, like, retired master sergeant. He was contracted back into the military, and he was one of the first people who brought it up to me. He was like, Kevin, I heard you think the earth is flat. I was like, yeah, I think it is. And then he laughed at me, just like we're all programmed to do, right? But nowadays, like 5-6 years later, my dad's actually starting to agree with it as well.
Right, and you know what? And it's interesting enough, on that subject, when we all first come into this massive awakening from the matrix, I'm talking about releasing your mind out of imprisonment that it's been in. Initially, I can't speak for you guys. I can only speak for myself. You get too exuberant, too excitable, you go through phases of anger, acceptance, calmness, peacefulness, godliness, ungodliness, you go through these phases, and I think that's got a lot to do with the fact that you woke up from the matrix maybe 6 years ago, and now they're starting to come around 5 years later. So it's not as but we evolve as well, not just
exactly
spiritually on how to handle the unsavory arguments that we get in, or contention that may exist between families and friends.
Well,
we're able to handle it a little bit better.
Oh, well, that's why you choose your battles.
Right.
You can lead a donkey to water, you can't make him drink. I can lead you to knowledge, I can't make you think. You literally have to choose your battles with certain people. And I've learned that with a lot of my close friends. I've literally told one of my close friends, I'd be better off talking to a brick wall than talking to you about this subject.
Right.
You know, right. People are open to it, and then some people aren't. But once you've done it for a long enough time, you realize who's going to be open to it and who's not going to be. And yes, right. You can plant seeds, and you can let them grow or not, but that's up to them. I'm not going to be forcing any ideology down to anybody's throat any way, shape, or form.
Unless you see that door kind of cracked open a little bit.
I see it peeked open, and I'll push open that door with my foot.
Right. Well, God, our creator, is able to give us enough wisdom to see those doors when they open, and not to go through it ourselves, but to depend on connecting that spirit man with the flesh man, I think is a perfect awakening once you get out of that matrix. And of course, a lot for some of us, including myself, it took some time, you know. And final thoughts on, we were trying to get Eddie Alencar in here, but I have Eddie actually coming on Ferret Radio next week, so on the 26th. He's in Japan, and but Eddie, we all want to tell you hello. It would have been great to get you on, and hello, Eddie, how you doing, guys? We see you next week, Eddie. And but anyway, guys, thank you for coming on, Vika Dreziv. We are very indebted to you because we feel like this is going to be the most impactful movie about truth and father, and we got the greatest people that I can ever. Oh, you know, where'd you find these guys, Vika? It's just a beautiful, beautiful thing. And Vika, we're gonna end the segment by you're gonna get the final words in, and I'm gonna tell everybody goodbye for the night, and hope to see you guys real soon. And Vika, your thoughts, final thoughts.
I would like to add that Kevin, too, is big truther. He does a lot for the community. He's even been in against the Congress for the fluoride. He goes conference around. He's known in the Spanish community, flat earth community. He's a big truther. And also Rob and you yourself, we all are doing our part to get together. And we're going to try to always get better. And it's a pleasure to be with all of you here. And for definitely we're going to do more sessions together. Yep. A big hug for everyone.
That sounds great. And Kevin Bobick, thank you for coming on, sir. Thank you all for your service for this country. We're very much indebted to you. It's partly because of guys like you that made the United States of America one of the greatest countries in the world. We still stand by our principles. We still have the Second Amendment, Vika, over here in the U.S. As long as we have guns, buddy, we're going to be a thorn in their sides. And they ain't going to come get our guns. I can tell you that. Thank you, Rick Lowtech, for coming on. My co-host, Josh Silva, thank you so much. And I hope to see you guys. Rob Taylor, I always see you. Rob and I talk almost every day. So, but thank you for coming on. And again, guys, Thank you for your service for the country.
Second Amendment, here it is.
We cannot wait. We cannot wait to for this film documentary to come out called Flatten the Curve. Guys, order your T-shirts. I'm going to order one, and I hope you guys follow my lead. And
this is another segment
of Hoodwinked into the Age of Insanity. I am your host, Mark Hollander. Thank you guys for listening. Good night, and God bless.
Thank you. Good night. Thank you.